offer up our lives to you as a living sacrifice, God. Lord, pleasing to you and ready to do your work. Father, speak to our hearts this morning. Open up our eyes, our minds, our ears, and our hearts to you. Lord, remind us, God, how much you love us. Lord, that you have great plans for each and every one of us. Lord, you are great and we love you. We pray all these things in your son's name, we pray. Amen. Why don't we take a couple minutes right now and greet one another this morning?
All right. Wow. Can you imagine, guys? That's what we're going to be doing in heaven, singing our praise to God. Oh, man. I can't wait. Well, I'll have to wait. Okay. All righty. Well, let me welcome you to Grace Calvary Chapel. If you're new to the fellowship, maybe you're passing through, and if you've not filled this out, please do so. It's just our way of getting to know you. All right? Now, on the back side, there's a place for prayer. So if you don't have anything to pray about, you can pray for me, okay? So put that down here and throw it in the box over here. It's an agape box. There's one in front. There's one in the back. All right. On to the announcements. Men's and women's and youth Bible studies have begun. They began last Wednesday, all right? And they start at 7, not 7:30 like we used to. Guess what? Everybody's welcome, all right? So please come. Grace Calvary Chapel, family night, family skate night, he tried to say. It's going to be at Skateland West. It's right down the street here, September the 16th, from 6:30 until 8:30. The cost is $4 if you skate, and it's absolutely free if you don't skate. All righty. The men's retreat, October 18th to the 19th, to be held at this church. The cost is $45. The sign-up, you can do it online, I think, and you can see Pastor Mike, too, probably, but there's also information right outside in the information booth. Children's ministry meeting, that's September the 29th at 10 p.m. in the youth room, right? It's in between services. Okay, now, if you would indulge me for a second, I'm going to go off script. There's a great need in this church. We need men to step up for security. Now, I've been put in charge of that, so if you want to, serve in this church, you can serve in that capacity, right? I think we only have like 4 guys that serve regularly, okay? My plan is if you have 16 guys, we could serve one a month, right? Is that in you to serve here in security once a month, guys? If you can, please sign up. I'll put up a sheet up there in a little while, or talk to me, okay? And I want to thank you. And Pastor Joe, if you're ready, come on up.
All right. Good morning. FYI, those men's, women's youth studies are on Wednesday night. So that's Wednesday night. I think Rick gave some information. But Wednesday night at 7 o'clock, not 7:30. We used to do 7:30. We're toning it back to 7. Hopefully get more people out. Time is an issue sometimes, right? There's nothing happening on Wednesdays anyway, is there? There's no Monday night football. There's no Thursday night football. It's a freebie. It's open. Okay. Tomorrow is skate night. Skate night. Put on your disco your disco hat or whatever. For those of you who used to skate during the disco days, put on your disco hat and come on down and get ready to boogie. Amen. Okay, let's stand. Let's read this little portion of scripture. We're going to finish chapter 2 of Romans this morning. And we're going to read beginning in verse 25. We'll read till verse 29. For circumcision indeed is of value if you obey the law, but if you break the law, your circumcision becomes uncircumcision. So if a man who is circumcised keeps the precepts of the law, will not his uncircumcision be regarded as circumcision? Then he who is physically uncircumcised but keeps the law will condemn you who have the written code and circumcision but break the law. For no one is a Jew who is merely one outwardly, nor is circumcision outward and physical, but a Jew is one inwardly. And circumcision is a matter of the heart, by the spirit, not by the letter. His praise is not from man, but from God. Let's pray. Lord, again, thank you for your word and your truth, and pray that you would teach us now through your spirit and help us to make application in our lives. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Romans 2, 25 to 29. Circumcision is a heart matter. As a heart matter, you could say a matter of the heart. We'll look at this in three parts. First, verse 25, circumcision as an empty ritual. Verses 26, 27, circumcision condemned. And then finally, 28, 29, circumcision is inward. So in this portion of scripture, well, you know, let me share something before we continue there. Something that I was thinking about, saying something about it. But this past week, one of the associate pastors at Harvest Christian Fellowship committed suicide. He was 30 years old, had a couple of kids, reminded me certainly of the young man last year who pastored a church there in Chino Hills who had committed suicide as well. Same age around, a couple of kids, and took his life. And all I want to tell you is, suicide certainly is not the answer to your trials and to your tribulations. And I realize there are a lot of people who suffer and go through difficulties, anxiety, fear, worry, or depression, you know, panic attacks, and so on and so forth. And they have a difficult time dealing with that. And it reminds me back when I was serving in Albuquerque at Calvary Chapel there. When I made the decision to come to San Antonio, then they spoke to me and said, "Who do you want to take over the mid-high group?" Because I used to work with the children's ministry in the mid-high group. And I gave them a couple of names. I gave them the name of one guy who had been with the mid-high group for years, had served for in and out of that group for many years, had served the previous leader, and then had served a little bit under me as well. And I think his probably heart was broken when he didn't get the position that I got the position. And so I said, "Well, why don't you give Eddie a chance?" And they said, "No, we they knew stuff I didn't know about him." And I said, "Okay." They gave it to some other guy. Now go back a couple of years after that, and what ends up happening is Eddie ends up taking his life. He actually worked as a mortician, and he gave specific detail as to what to do with his body. And he cut his wrist when he was laying down in the bathtub, and so that the blood would drain, and you know, and he would make a bloody mess, and just a bunch of different things. And because he had ministered to the youth for so long, we had the conundrum, you could say. And what's the conundrum? For Christians, the conundrum is this. If you commit suicide, do you go to heaven? Right? Now, if you tell the kids yes, Then what are you telling the youth? You're telling them it's okay, right? It's not okay. Okay, now I'm not telling you where Eddie went, because I really don't know. I would think it's a sin like any other sin. Certainly that is forgiven by the grace of God. But understand, you don't want to give people that out. You don't want to give them that out. It's never the answer to your problems. Never the answer. It's not a last resort. Okay? Not a last resort. And you always need to run to the Lord when you're in that difficult time. Obviously, we're frail, we're weak, and whatever. Well, that's why when you're weak, he's strong, the Bible says. Right? Because we're all weak. I mean, that's why we're here in church this morning, because we need Jesus. And so understand that. Don't think it's the answer to your problem. It's not the answer to your problem. Jesus is the answer to your problem. Always will be. And so that's certainly our position. We don't want to give anyone that out. That, I'm saved. I'll just take my life because I don't like this life. And yeah. So just saying that, if you're struggling with that, run to Jesus. And I'm not certainly telling you it'll disappear, but it's like any other thing that we deal with. You deal with it, and you continue to deal with it, and it's a struggle for many. But you know what? It's like Charles Spurgeon said: dead men don't wrestle. You guys understand that? Dead men. If you're not alive in Christ, you could care less. But when you're alive in Christ, there's going to be wrestling going on in your heart, right? You're spiritually dead. Dead men don't wrestle. But let's look at circumcision on another note. Not that it's a joyful topic, certainly, but we'll look at first circumcision as an empty ritual. In this portion of Scripture, Paul is certainly speaking directly to the Jews. And I know that in this room, there probably aren't any Jews. Are any of you Jews? Raise your hand. I didn't think so. Okay, let's go to chapter 3. No, but there's really, even while the text itself speaks to the Jew, there's application for us as Christians and as believers. We know that from Romans chapter 1, Paul's speaking to the heathen, what we would call the heathen, the sinner. You look at their life and you go, well, they're drunk, they're whatever, they're this, they're that. Oh, yeah, they're not going to heaven, right? Look at them. But now he includes others. He includes the moral, those who look good on the outside. And then he includes the religious. There's a lot of religious people in this world. And the problem with religion is, unfortunately, people trust in their religion rather than trusting in Jesus. And that's what Paul, that's really the idea here. People were trusting in their religion, specifically is the Jew. The Jew was trusting in their religion and in that ritual of circumcision. I got circumcised. Of course I'm going to heaven, right? It'd be like somebody say, well, I was baptized. And truthfully, it doesn't mean anything at all if it wasn't in your heart. Doesn't mean anything. The ritual doesn't mean anything at all. And we need to understand that, because as Christians, there's a lot of rituals that we go through. I'm not telling you it's a good thing to be baptized, right? But it always should be an outward sign of what God has already done inside of you. Where he's given you, where you've died with him and now you've risen again with him. So Paul, speaking to the Jews, says this in verse 25, for circumcision is indeed of value if you obey the law, but if you break the law, your circumcision becomes uncircumcision. Now, for the Jew, this need to be circumcised comes from Genesis 17, 9 through 14. And it reads as such, and God said to Abraham, as for you, you shall keep my covenant, you and your offspring after you through their generations. This is my covenant, which you shall keep between me and you and your offspring after you. Every male among you shall be circumcised. And so it's for men only. Right? Why? Right? Well, I'll try to explain it to you in a little bit here. You shall be circumcised in the flesh of your foreskins, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and you. He who was 8 days old among you shall be circumcised. So there is, you're eight days old. Every male through your generations, whether born in your house or bought with your money from any foreigner who is not of your offspring, both he and who is born in your house and he who is bought with your money shall surely be circumcised. So shall my covenant be in your flesh, an everlasting covenant. Any uncircumcised male who is not circumcised in the flesh of his foreskin shall be cut off from his people. He has broken my covenant. There's a covenant. I'm going to make you a great nation. You're going to be a bless. I'm going to bless you so you can what? Have a lot of blessings? No, so you can bless others. I'm going to bless you so you can bless others. But this sign I want you to keep. You're going to be circumcised. And this came 500 years before the law is given to Moses. So it's 500 years before that. There was no law at this time. But circumcision is a sign of the covenant between God and the Israelites. And why men only? Well, because aside from physical reasons, the idea is that the man will supply the seed, and then because he struggles in this area, God wants your heart to be circumcised. This covenant. Did you know the Jews weren't the only people to be circumcised? I think sometimes we think that. We almost think baptism is just for Christians, or, you know, there are a lot of people who get baptized. Jews would get baptized to become Jewish. They would go into the water. It's not just the Christian ritual. We sometimes don't quite understand. Circumcision wasn't just Jewish as well. It's certainly given to the Jew by God, as Scripture says that, but there are other people. Egyptians would get circumcised. Muslims would sometimes get circumcised, and just others. But circumcision was always meant to be an outward sign of an inward change. But what ended up happening is it began as something good, but then it turned into this ritual and ultimately into this magic charm. Right? I'm circumcised. I'm a Jew. I'm special. I'm unique. I'm going to heaven, so much so that a couple of the sayings that the rabbis came up with were, circumcised men do not descend into Gehenna, or they don't go to hell. Another word for hell, circumcision. Secondly, circumcision will deliver Israel from Gehenna. But yet, for instance, there's a verse in Deuteronomy 10:16. It says, therefore, circumcise the foreskin of your heart and be stiff-necked no longer. So Paul begins speaking to the Jews. For circumcision is indeed of value if you obey the law. So if the ritual then, if you're a Jew and you're circumcised and then you follow the law, the Jews had the law, right? And you do what the law says, well then, hey, it's all right. But, he continues, if you break the law, your circumcision becomes uncircumcision. Then, what does it mean? It doesn't mean anything. It was an empty ritual then. The New Living Testament translates it this way, but if you don't obey God's law, you are no better off than an uncircumcised Gentile. And so he's hitting the Jew right in the heart by telling them this and telling them, and they're like, hold on, you're attacking my religion, right? You know how that feels, don't you? Some of you who were previously Catholic, maybe Roman Catholic, maybe some of you even still are. You're attacking my religion, right? You know how this? You're not a Christian, you know, or whatever it is, right? There you are. You're not just attacking my religion. You're attacking my grandma and my grandpa. They brought me up like that. You know, you're attacking my whole family. You're attacking the whole culture. You know, just go on and go forward. Well, maybe. I don't know. Might be. But that's the idea here. It doesn't mean anything then. It's sort of like a wedding ring. As long as you're faithful, the wedding ring means something. But become unfaithful, it doesn't mean anything. Right? Why wear it? What does it mean? You put it on, you made a covenant, right? In good times and bad times. In times of much, in times of lease, and good health and bad health, you know, and all these things that you said, and then you're unfaithful. What does it mean? That covenant that you made, you broke the covenant. That's what Paul is saying here. You're not obeying the law. Doesn't mean anything. What's the application for us? Well, you know, as Christians, there's a lot of ritual in Christianity, unfortunately. And some of the things we do, even though they have good intentions, they can become rituals, can't they? You could take baptism. Now, there are people, a lot of Protestants, who believe if they've been baptized, they're going to heaven. But it never changes their life. Their heart is still as wicked as it was before they got dipped in water. Oh, but I got baptized. You know, and you got to be baptized, brother. And then I got baptized. Doesn't mean anything. Unless you really meant it. Then it means something, right? Then it becomes a special day, and it's a beautiful thing, and other people are there to celebrate with you. But if you didn't really mean it, if you thought, no, I got to do this because this is how one person is saved, you're not saved by baptism. Doesn't save anybody. And if you're trusting in that, you're lost. That's just the reality of it. You're lost. You need Jesus. And that's what Paul is trying to tell the Jews. Circumcision is an empty ritual if it doesn't change your heart. And I don't know how many 8-year-old boys were changed. You know what I'm saying? There are a lot of us who were baptized as infants. What did that do? It got you wet. And usually not your whole body. You just got sprinkled on your forehead a little bit there. You know? Didn't do anything else. You got a little bit wet, just towel them off, and then, yeah. Or christened, or whatever it may be. It's an empty ritual. Secondly, circumcision is condemned, and not by God per se, but by others. It says in verse 26, so if a man who is uncircumcised keeps the precepts of the law, will not his uncircumcision be regarded as circumcision? So Paul is setting up this idea. Well, let's say there's somebody who keeps the law, but hasn't been circumcised. Well, he almost is like a person who's been circumcised. Why? Because he's kept the law. In other words, he's doing what the circumcision people should have done, even though he wasn't circumcised. He hasn't been circumcised. And so keeping the law is certainly of great value, isn't it? In a sense. But does it get you to heaven? Not necessarily. But does it help you? And does it help your life? Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. You obey the law. You obey the government. Just look at it practically. You don't speed. What happens? You don't get a traffic ticket. How much are traffic tickets today? Some of you know. You can tell me. Oh, well, I've taken Frank's class. around four times. You know, it's of great value when you don't break the law, isn't it? You don't have to mess with that. That's just one little, tiny little aspect of it. Imagine if your kids were obedient. Hallelujah. You'd be like, oh my gosh, what happened? But you know how they are. They're like you. Believe me, youngsters, adults are the same way. I don't want to do that. They say the same thing. They just don't say it in that way. You know, you're not my boss. You're not. Believe me, when God tells them to do something, they're like, you're not my boss. They might not say it out loud, but believe me, they're no different. They're disobedient. And so he's setting up an example, and maybe even thinking back to those people who never had circumcision, Job, Enoch, Noah. You know, how are they going to be in heaven? How are they? Did Jesus preach to them? Well, they trusted that God would get them there because they trusted in the Lord. And so they, even though they looked to the cross, and they didn't look, you know, back at the cross as we do, they looked forward to the cross that God would provide a way for them. That's how they get to go in. And so circumcision here, will not his uncircumcision be regarded as circumcision? Then he who is physically uncircumcised but keeps the law, well, what? Will condemn you who have the written code and circumcision but break the law. Now, he may not say, I issue a condemnation against you. That's really not the matter here. But the way in which he lives should speak to you. The way in which he lives. There are those people who live such a life that though they may not be a Christian, you may say to yourselves, man, they would make good Christians. Just to the way they live their lives. They're moral. And everything they do seems like, wow, that's how Christians should act, right? I was reading some commentator, and I don't even remember the verse, but it wasn't even a biblical commentator. It was a satirical commentator speaking on Christianity and about Christians, and he said, he wrote something, he goes, you know why Jesus hung up with the sinners and gluttons and wine bibbers and, you know, drunks and all this stuff? Because he didn't want to hang out with the Christians. He'd rather hang out with those other folks. You know, he's being sarcastic, but was he? Yeah, was he? So circumcised man, he who is physically uncircumcised but keeps the law, and I think the idea here is that his life condemns you. His life condemns you. Here you have the advantage, right? And we spoke about the advantage last week. You have the advantage. You have the law. You are God's chosen people. You have the covenant of circumcision. You have all these things. And later on in Romans, Paul will go over all the advantages that the Jews had. You have all these advantages, and you don't take advantage of them. And then we learned that as a Christian, we have more. Because we don't only have the Old Testament, we have the New Testament. We have translation upon translation of. You can get it in any sort of language you want it in. Any type of English almost. And then you have the Holy Spirit living in your heart and in your life. So we should be the ones who are without excuse. We don't have an excuse. But yet we always offer excuses. And so they will condemn you. They keep the law and they're condemned. You're the ones who should be keeping the law, but you're not. They are. And it should be a condemnation then for them. So how about, so are you trusting then in things that you shouldn't trust in your relationship with Christ? How do you judge your relationship with Christ? How do you, you know, if you were given, if you were asked to rate your relationship with the Lord from 1 to 10, what would you give yourself? You know? And how would you even come up with that number? You know, well, you know, I go to church, I pray, I read, I give, you know, and all these things, right? I'm a 10. I'm a 10. Yeah, you know, you're, but you always think of you as a 10. So you don't, you know, when, you know, who do you, when people ask, who do you look like? It's always a famous actor or actress, you know? You know, well, I look like Brad Pitt, obviously. You're like, orale. You know, everybody's all like, orale. Bro, I don't know what mirror you're looking in, but yeah, you don't. You know, really, how do we judge our relationship with God? And, you know, hopefully we don't judge it by rituals. I've been baptized, right? Or I've done this, or I've done that. Hopefully it's solely because of Jesus. The only reason I'm a Christian is because of Jesus, not because of me, but because of him. And so if you ask somebody, are you a Christian? Hopefully the answer is, oh yeah, I've been a member of First Baptist Church for 25 years. I'm a member. You know what a member is? I'm signed into membership. We don't have most Calvaries don't have memberships. There are those few that do. And I won't say nothing because it's better kept unsaid. You know what I mean? But most Calvaries don't have memberships. I'm a member. Or are you a Christian? Well, yeah, I go to Calvary Chapel. Well, which Calvary Chapel? I mean, which side are you on? Are you CCA? Calvary Chapel Association, or are you CGN, the Calvary Global Network? Which Calvary are you? You're like, I know, some of you are like, you didn't know that? That's good that you don't understand that question. You know, some people say, well, I'm CGN, and you'd be like, you're lost, bro. Don't you know that? That's not. You're going to let women be, for long, women are going to be teaching Sunday mornings. You know, so on down the line. That's all I'll say about that. That way you don't get me in trouble. Cut this from the radio, okay? Cut this part from the radio. No, I'm Calvary Chapel. Are you a believer? Yeah, I was baptized. I've been baptized twice. Once as a baby, and then later on as an adult. I'm going to heaven. I was baptized. And, you know, you're still living like a heathen. It didn't change your life. Not that baptism changes your life, but Jesus coming into your life didn't change. If God comes into your heart, what does he do? He changes your heart. He changes your heart. Now, I'm not telling you he makes you, you know, Paul the Apostle. Overnight. No, there's some work, there's some sanctification, and there'll be ups and downs, certainly, but you have the written code, he tells them, and circumcision, but you break the law. In other words, circumcision doesn't get you saved. And so, on another little side note, because people will ask sometimes, well, you know, what about those people in parts of the world who've never heard about Jesus? And that's their objection to the gospel, to Jesus being the only way. What about them? Jesus never preached to them. Do they go to heaven? You know, what happened? How did they get saved? Maybe, let me give you a couple of other questions. What about those who hear the gospel and reject it? What about them? They hear it and they still say no. What about you? You're commanded to take the gospel to those pygmies in Africa. What about you? Maybe they don't have the gospel because you've decided, I don't want to. What about you? You know, people are complaining. Well, you know, they never hear, well, I'm not going to live in America. I'm not going to leave America. Everybody wants to become an American. I'm not going to leave America. God forbid you send me to Mexico. They're our neighbor. You know, I don't care about those people. I mean, you may not say it like that, but you, that's how you live. I don't really care about them. You know? God sends some other fool to go, you know, and if you want to go spend your life out there sharing the gospel and living on rice and beans or whatever, hey, God bless you. That's not me. I got to go get my Starbucks, you know? So that's the question. What about you? Talking about people and wherever. Do you share the gospel? It's just that simple. The circumcision is an empty ritual. Circumcision condemned. Third point, circumcision is inward. And that's the point Paul is trying to get to them and to us. For no one is a Jew who is merely one outwardly, nor is circumcision outward and physical. In other words, circumcision was not just meant to be an outward ritual as applied to the Jew. Now, it's certainly, if it has no religious intention behind it, well, then it just becomes a medical procedure. There are kids who get circumcised who aren't Jewish and, you know, for reasons. And there's pros and cons, I think. I think, you know, 5,000 years ago, it was good medicine. Today, a little different story, maybe. But no one is a Jew. Just because you were circumcised doesn't make you Jewish. So what's the application? Just because you're baptized doesn't make you a Christian. Just because you go to church doesn't make you a Christian. You know, you can do all those things. It doesn't make you a Christian. It's your heart. That matters. Has there been a change in your heart? And when you told Jesus, I give you my heart, but you're telling him you give him everything? All of you. Not just part of you. A lot of people just want to give Jesus a little bit. Oh, take the bad part, Lord. Don't take it all, though. Jesus said, I want it all. On your entire life. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Not just Sunday. I want your entire life. Jews were sometimes called, you know, what's the deal with being called a Jew? Well, it comes from the tribe of Judah. They shortened it Jew. And then it became, you know, initially it was just for the tribe of Judah, but then it incorporated everybody, all Jews. Sometimes they're called Hebrews, right? Hebrew was the language they spoke. And sometimes they're called Israelites, the land that they lived in, certainly from Israel, a covenant agreement they had with the Lord as God's chosen people. So Jew, Hebrew, Israelites, I think Paul called himself a Hebrew of Hebrews. But it's not the outward that's important. It's the inward. It's the inward. 1922, Howard Carter. You guys know Howard Carter, right? Some of you do. Howard Carter, what did he do? He, British archaeologist, he made one of the greatest discoveries of all time. Him and his team found King Tut's sarcophagus. Great sarcophagus, wasn't it? So they find this big old ornate coffin. And really, it was a coffin inside of a coffin. It wasn't just one coffin, but this huge thing, they found it. And inside, they brought this burial case, and there's decorations on it, stone, whatever. They opened it, and they found another coffin. It was made out of wood, but gold leaf was over it. And inside of that, they found another one. Solid gold. And they opened that, and there was this gold mask on top of the head of King Tut. You've probably seen that before. But you take that mask off, and underneath was this old, dead, wrinkly man. Looked good on the outside, you know? On the inside, dead and wrinkly. And that's what the Lord is trying to say. If you're religious and all you have is the outward appearance, doesn't mean anything. Because once you take off that mask, you're dead and old and wrinkly. You're still spiritually dead. In verse 29, he says, but a Jew is one inwardly, and circumcision is a matter of the heart. See? It's a matter of what happens inside. By the Spirit. Not by the letter. Letter is sometimes another way of saying the law. Not by the law. By the Spirit. His praise is not from man, but from God. And they should have known this. Jeremiah 4:4, it says, circumcise yourself to the Lord and remove the foreskins of your heart, men of Judah, inhabitants of Jerusalem, lest my wrath go forth like fire and burn with none to quench it because of the evil of your deeds. There again, in Deuteronomy 10:16, therefore circumcise the foreskin of your heart and be stiff-necked no longer. 1 Samuel 16:7, the Lord said to Samuel, do not look at his appearance or at the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For God sees not as man sees, for man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the what? The heart. Heart. So what does a Christian look like? Well, he looks like other people, except he's a Christian. And you know, that was the one thing that Calvary Chapel, original Calvary now, that's the one thing they understood, that it is always a matter of the heart. It wasn't a matter of their outward appearance, because back then, a lot of religious people and the hippies would come to church. But people in their suit and ties and in their Sunday dress and their hats and all that, you know, some hippie comes in and they're like, no, don't let them in. We're closed, you know. They don't want them to come in. They're dirty. I mean, let's just be under. Physically, they were dirty. They hadn't taken a bath in a few days. Yeah. They smelled. They weren't wearing any shoes. They were, you know, it's like, you're coming into the Lord's house, bro. I mean, come on. It's Jesus' house. Be holy as he is holy. He didn't mean dress your best, but, you know, and I understand it's a matter of the heart. If you truly love the Lord and the Lord tells you, you know, dress up because I want you to honor me. Hey, fine. That's fine. Nothing wrong with that. You should allow people to do that. But, you know, Calvary let hippies in. Church began to explode, right? And one time after they had moved into one building, they had put carpet in the sanctuary and And the elders of the church put no shoes, no carpet. You can't walk on the carpet in your bare feet because the oil off your feet will destroy the carpet. Pastor Chuck told him, well, either take off the sign or take off the carpet. It's ridiculous. It's not a matter of what you're wearing or how, you know, it's the matter of your heart. And I still remember my buddy. His first name was Sky. I thought it was Cielo, but we nicknamed him Cielo. It was Sky. Sky was his name. His mom was a hippie. I think his sister was named Moon or something like that. But his name was Sky. And when Sky first walked into Calvary Albuquerque, he had this Flock of Seagulls haircut. Remember the Flock of Seagulls? I mean, you know, he was like, and you're like, is that the dude from the Flock of Seagulls? If you don't know what it is, Google it, and you'll be like, oh, he walks into church, and I'm like, I'm a brand new believer. They let people like that into church. Yeah, they do. Flock of Seagulls. Check that out. And his entourage, there were other, I mean, some were dressed like goth. Some had this white, I don't know, they're like white-faced. You know, you've heard of blackface? White-face, which was totally weird. You know, I'm just saying it. But then you get to know Sky, and you go, he loves Jesus. Eventually, he lost the hair. But, you know, the Lord, I don't know what happened. I probably got just too much problem, right, to be fixing his hair. Like, he goes, man, I don't need this thing anymore. Give me a crew cut. Make it easy. No, it's a matter of the heart. It's a matter of the heart. You know, your heart needs to be circumcised. And what does Paul say about this person? His praise is not from man, but from God. You know, so you can walk in and you can say all the right stuff. You can do all the right things. And men, you know, you want to be praised by men. And people think that people are always, I'll say this, I'll try not to be too harsh, that people are always thinking about them. And all I can tell you is people think much less of you than you think they do. And I don't mean that in a bad way. It's just, you know, oh, they're always there. You know, they're thinking about me. They're doing something. They're, you know, it's behind the scenes or whatever. No. Who do people think about most? Themselves. They think about themselves. They don't have time to think about you. They're thinking about themselves. Because we're all selfish and self-centered. And here we are thinking, oh, no, they were thinking that, you know, they're thinking this, they're thinking that about me. They're thinking about themselves, people. Come on. Stop worrying about what people are thinking already. Dear Lord. You know, your praise doesn't come from man. It comes from who? From God. God, he's the only one you should be concerned with. The only one. You know, and if he thinks well, I think everyone else will as well. Right? If you live your life to please the Lord and it's pleasing unto him, you'll be okay with everybody else, I think. The only thing that matters, it matters what Jesus thinks. So Romans 1 says, no one is so bad that he can't be saved. Romans 2 says, no one is so good that he doesn't need to be saved. Everybody needs Jesus. The bad person, the religious person, the moral person, they all need Jesus. They all need him. And remember, God looks at your heart. God looks at your heart. And so the final question I want to ask each of us is, when we gave our hearts to the Lord, did we give him everything? Or are we withholding something from him? telling him, you can't have that, Lord. That's not yours. He wants everything. All of it. Stop trying to hold on to whatever it is. Let him have it, and he can do far more with it than you ever could. That's the truth. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your grace and your mercy. And Lord, I do pray, Lord, if there's any in here who have not truly given their life to you but are trusting in an empty ritual, that you would speak to their hearts and bring them to yourself, into a living relationship with the living God. And so that's you this morning. If you're trusting in your religion or in something that you did as a kid, in order to get to heaven, understand it, heaven comes only through Jesus Christ. And so that's you this morning, but you want to make your life right with God. And you want to truly receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. And then raise your hand and we'll pray for you. Pray that Jesus would truly be the Lord and Savior of your life, and that he would not only work in you, but through you. Lord, I do thank you for each one here, and just pray, Lord, you help each of us to give you all of our hearts, Lord, every single part of it. We love you, and we pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen.